Earlier, we introduced Q-learning and explained that it is an off-policy algorithm, meaning that its behavior policy and target policy can be different. While the two policies are not required to be the same, of course they can be the same without causing any problems. If we force the behavior policy and target policy to be the same, we essentially get an on-policy implementation of an off-policy algorithm. Now, let's examine the on-policy and off-policy implementations of Q-learning. The on-policy version of Q-learning is identical to SARSA except the Q-value update part. In the SASA algorithm, the update involves the term QT, ST, plus 1, AT, plus 1. It has now been replaced with the term above the line, and the remaining policy update also uses epsilon greedy. The process is as follows. Start with an initial policy. Use this policy to generate data, update the Q value with the data, improve the policy based on the Q values using an epsilon greedy approach, and repeat. This policy serves as the one used to generate data, meaning it is the behavior policy. Since it is continuously updated, it is also the target policy. Therefore, it is an on-policy implementation. For the off-policy implementation of Q-learning, we assume there is a behavior policy PiB that generated some experience samples. Our task is to find the optimal policy based on these experience samples. Here's how it works. We pay attention to the corresponding status actions and rewards I receive at time t. First, update Q value. This step is identical to the on-policy implementation and follows the standard Q-learning algorithm. Second, update target policy. This step differs from the on-policy implementation. Instead of using epsilon greedy, we update as a greedy policy, which we name as pi t. Why is it greedy instead of epsilon greedy here? The reason is that epsilon greedy is primarily for generating sufficient experience samples and needs some level of exploration to cover unvisited states and actions. But now this policy is not used to generate experience samples and does not have to be exploratory. So, why keep it epsilon greedy? It should simply be greedy because greedy policies are known to be optimal. As the estimation of Q values becomes more accurate, pi t will also converge to an optimal policy. Clearly, there are two distinct policies here, pi b and pi t. This is a clear off-policy implementation. We have now finished introducing the Q-learning algorithm and its key properties. Next, let's look at some examples to better understand this algorithm. We will continue using grid-world examples. In this example, our task is to find an optimal policy for all the states. This is different from the example we used to test SARSA, where we only needed to find a path from a specified starting state to the target state. In the task here, we need to find the optimal policy for all states, not just a specific path. This distinction is important, so please pay attention to the specific requirements of each task. Here are some setup details for the grid world example, including the reward and the discount factor. The grid world example looks like this. First, we define the ground truth. This is the optimal policy, and this is the corresponding optimal state values. After running Q-learning, we will compare the resulting policy to this ground truth to see how well the algorithm performs. First, we select a behavior policy and use this behavior policy to generate a lot of samples. This behavior policy has already been illustrated with arrows. It is essentially a uniformly sampling policy. That means at each state, where I have five actions, each action is given a probability of 0.2, indicating strong exploratory behavior. As shown in the right figure, if we have a million steps in this episode, each state action pair is visited many times, so these samples are quite good. Next, let's see how to use these samples to do Q-learning. To use the data generated by this behavior policy, we must use the off-policy implementation of Q-learning. What we can get eventually is a policy that is almost the same to the ground truth optimal policy that we just mentioned. There are some minor differences, like one direction being down and the other left. The optimality of this policy can also be demonstrated in the right figure. What does the vertical axis represent? It represents the value difference during the estimation process. More specifically, Q-learning outputs a series of policies, each corresponding to a state value. We know its optimal state value, and then we can calculate the difference between them, which is what the vertical axis shows. Initially, the policy is not very good. There is a huge difference from the optimal state value. But ultimately, the policy becomes very good, and the corresponding state value is almost identical to the optimal one. The behavior policy we just used is highly exploratory. In our task, we need to find the optimal policy for each SA pair, which means we need to visit all SA pairs many times. Therefore, it would be best if the behavior policy is highly exploratory. When it's not very exploratory, let's see the following example. Suppose we use a policy where epsilon equals 0.5, but there is a significantly higher probability of moving right at each state. Clearly, its exploratory ability is not as good as before. With a million steps, many state action pairs have not even been visited. If we use such data for Q-learning, you will see that the policy obtained in the end is still quite far from the optimal policy. I don't show the final policy here, but I show a figure that can demonstrate why the final policy is not optimal. If we consider an even less exploratory policy, say epsilon equals 0.1, then there's a higher likelihood that the policy will choose to move right at nearly every state. The data obtained in such a case would be even worse, and the final policy obtained is also poorer. Since epsilon is quite small, the policy's exploratory ability is poor. The resulting samples lead to significant errors in the final policy obtained.